A bosom friend afar brings a distant land near. Good morning, today is Sunday, June 30, 2024. Today in history, on this day 113 years ago, the Polish-American poet, essayist, and literary historian Czesław Miłosz was born. His notable works include The Captive Mind, The Isa Valley, Selected Poems, and The Land of Ulro. Miłosz's style is characterized by its simplicity and strength, avoiding excessive formalism and external poetic ornamentation. Yet, his poems resonate with profound power, earning him the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1980. Qing Qiao, bridging the business world and delivering information to you. Welcome to today's Qing Qiao Morning News. Let's start with political updates. U.S. sanctions nearly 50 companies and individuals for facilitating fund transfers to Iran. According to Reuters, on June 25, the United States imposed sanctions on nearly 50 companies and individuals, accusing them of transferring billions of dollars to the Iranian military. The sanctions primarily target dozens of companies located in Hong Kong, the United Arab Emirates, and the Marshall Islands, as well as entities in Iran and Turkey. These measures freeze all U.S. assets belonging to the sanctioned entities and prohibit Americans from engaging in transactions with them. Additionally, companies doing business with these entities risk facing sanctions themselves. U.S. Treasury Undersecretary Adeyemo stated that the sanctions aim to disrupt a vast shadow banking system exploited by the Iranian military to launder oil proceeds and other illicit income amounting to billions of dollars. The sanctioned entities are alleged to have facilitated the Iranian Ministry of Defense and Armed Forces Logistics, along with the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps, in establishing a shadow banking network since 2020, enabling these entities to access the international financial system and process substantial funds. Secondly, we'll bring you updates on military-related news. North Korea successfully tests multi-warhead missile destruction capability. According to the Korean Central News Agency, on June 26, the North Korean Missile General Administration successfully conducted a test involving the separation and guidance of a missile mobile combat unit. The objective of the test was to enhance the capability to neutralize multiple warheads on individual targets. This test utilized the first stage engine of a medium to long-range solid-fuel ballistic missile, achieving a flight test range between 170 and 200 kilometers. The separated mobile warhead accurately struck three designated targets following guidance instructions. Additionally, the effectiveness of the decoy released from the missile was verified by the anti-aircraft target detector. The Missile General Administration of North Korea stated that these technical tests have now advanced into the testing phase, marking significant progress in upgrading North Korea's missile capabilities and technological development. The day before this test, the South Korean military reported that North Korea had tested a suspected hypersonic missile, but the projectile exploded mid-air. An official from South Korea's General Staff Headquarters mentioned that the suspected hypersonic missile failed after traveling approximately 250 kilometers. South Korean officials observed more smoke during this launch compared to previous ones, suggesting potential combustion issues. They also noted the possibility of solid propellant powering the missile. Japan also confirmed the launch, reporting that the missile crashed into the Sea of Japan, according to its Coast Guard. Now, let's turn our attention to the latest economic news. First economic dialogue held between U.S. and Vietnam. According to comprehensive news from Washington on June 25, Vietnam and the United States convened their inaugural economic dialogue in Washington, marking an agreement to collaborate across multiple sectors. U.S. officials underscored the robust nature of U.S.-Vietnam relations, with Deputy Secretary of State Fernandez affirming during the dialogue that the partnership remains strong. Discussions at the U.S.-Vietnam economic dialogue focused on economic security, semiconductors, investment environment, digital economy, cyberspace, energy, and critical minerals, aiming for extensive cooperation. Vietnam and the United States elevated their bilateral relations to a comprehensive strategic partnership just last year. However, Vietnam has yet to be recognized by the United States as a market economy country, a stance Hanoi views as potentially harmful to bilateral ties. Recently, Russian President Vladimir Putin's visit to Vietnam drew considerable attention from the United States, prompting Assistant Secretary of State Conda's subsequent visit to Hanoi. The U.S. reiterated its commitment to collaborating with Vietnam to safeguard a free and open Indo-Pacific region. This economic dialogue is seen as part of broader efforts to counterbalance Russian influence. Vietnam currently ranks as the United States' ninth largest trading partner, with bilateral trade amounting to $124 billion. EU accuses Microsoft of antitrust violations over Teams bundling with Office. According to Bloomberg News on June 25, the European Union has preliminarily found that Microsoft breached EU antitrust regulations by integrating its video application Teams with its enterprise application Office. This bundling practice has drawn accusations from Slack, a competing chat service, alleging that Microsoft's inclusion of Teams in its Office suite unfairly disadvantaged Slack in competing on an equitable basis. EU Competition Commissioner Vestager emphasized the importance of preserving competition in remote communication and collaboration tools to foster market innovation. If confirmed, Microsoft's actions would contravene EU competition laws. Penalties for such violations can amount to up to 10% of the company's global revenue, with Microsoft reporting $211 billion in revenue last fiscal year. Microsoft President Smith responded by stating the company's commitment to addressing EU concerns and seeking solutions to resolve the matter. Now, here is some important safety information. WHO alcohol kills 2.6 million people annually. According to Agence France-Presse on June 25, the World Health Organization, WHO, released its latest report on alcohol and health, stating that alcohol consumption results in 1 in 20 deaths worldwide each year. This includes fatalities from drunk driving, alcohol-induced violence, abuse, and various diseases. In 2019, alcohol was responsible for 2.6 million deaths globally, accounting for 4.7% of all deaths that year, with a significant majority among men. The age group most affected was 20 to 39 years old, comprising 13% of alcohol-related deaths. WHO Director General Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus emphasized the detrimental effects of alcohol on personal health, increasing the risk of chronic diseases, mental health issues, and millions of preventable deaths annually. The report highlighted that in 2019, 1.6 million deaths were due to non-communicable diseases associated with alcohol, including 474,000 from cardiovascular diseases and 401,000 from cancer. Binge drinking also heightens susceptibility to infectious diseases like tuberculosis, HIV, and pneumonia. Globally, approximately 200 million people, or 3.7% of the population, were dependent on alcohol. Europe recorded the highest per capita alcohol consumption, followed by the Americas. Finland first to implement bird flu vaccination. According to Reuters, Finland has recently procured preventive bird flu vaccines from CSL Seqirus for 10,000 people, making it the first country globally to embark on such a vaccination program against bird flu. The Finnish Institute of Health and Welfare announced that the vaccines will be administered to individuals aged 18 and above who are at higher risk due to occupational exposure or other circumstances. Although no human cases of bird flu have been reported in Finland to date, the country faced outbreaks among minks and foxes at most open-air fur farms last year, resulting in the culling of approximately 485,000 animals. Experts have pointed out Finland's unique risk profile due to its large number of fur farms and potential interaction between domesticated and wild animals. The initial phase of vaccination will target workers at fur farms, poultry farms, and those handling avian influenza samples, including laboratory technicians and veterinarians involved in animal control at fur farms. Finally, here's some intriguing cultural news. Lonsong Mekong Traditional Chinese Medicine Center unveiled in Phnom Penh, Cambodia. According to China News Network, on June 25, the Lonsong Mekong Traditional Chinese Medicine, TCM, Diagnosis, Treatment, and Cultural Promotion Center was opened at the COSMA China-Cambodia Friendship Hospital in Phnom Penh, Cambodia's capital. This center builds on the work of the Chinese TCM Foreign Aid Medical Team in Cambodia and the partnership between Gwangmyeon Hospital and COSMA China Cambodia Friendship Hospital. The center will serve as a place for TCM treatments, education, and cultural activities. It will offer medical services, training in TCM, and promote TCM culture. This is the first TCM clinic set up by the governments of China and Cambodia and will act as a platform for TCM exchanges in the Lansang Mekong region. They plan to hold free clinics, forums, training sessions, and create cultural spaces related to TCM to raise awareness and practice of TCM. Gwangmyeon Hospital of the China Academy of Chinese Medical Sciences has been actively expanding its international cooperation efforts, fostering partnerships with various countries including the United States, Singapore, Malaysia, Japan, and Cambodia. In Cambodia specifically, traditional Chinese medicine clinics and therapies have gained increasing acceptance among the local population. Financial newsletter. According to Xinhua Finance News, the price of iron ore has dropped a lot since late May. The Platts Iron Ore Price Index went down to $102.65 per ton, falling nearly 15%. Similarly, the main iron ore futures contract on the Dalian Commodity Exchange fell below 800 yuan per ton, also dropping by 14.5% from its highest point. That's all for today's Qingqiao Morning News. Thank you for listening.